Why do you call me at this time?
You promised us a painless death if we give ourselves up. Come and get us.
You can wait. Call me again at another time.
Welcome to another edition of the Hormonal Werewolves. We already recorded once this week, so it is not Werewolf Wednesday. It is Fanged Out Friday, or whatever we decide to call it. We are the weekly horror show podcast. Are you a podcast if you're not actually on
Spotify? No, we're a show.
Okay,
we're
so
not,
we're a show.
We're not podcasts. We're a show.
All right, so we're a show. You're a weekly horror YouTube show. That talks about old horror movies, newer horror movies, and
sometimes not even horror movies.
No, yes, a lot of times, like, you know, just kind of whatever the fuck we want to talk about. I'm one of your hosts, Adam. Of course, as usual, we have our other hosts, Abby and Ryan, and we also have our very, very special guest, our poltergeist expert, as you were, as you will, Nicole. How's everyone doing?
We're good. How are you?
Nicole, I love the outfit, by the way.
It's perfect. Oh, thank you. Yes.
We need to put a special spotlight on the 65 jersey.
Yeah, it's perfect.
That jersey and scene changed my life.
Changed Adam's
as a young man.
Yes.
Facts.
Pretty sure I sprouted my first chest hair after I
puberty just came out like that. It's amazing.
Yep.
So, yes, today we decided we wanted to talk about Poltergeist, which I know Nicole is a huge fan of. I am also a huge fan of. And what about you boys?
Oh, yeah, I love it. Absolutely love this movie.
You're my wild card.
It's all right.
I knew it.
Good goodness.
We're going to have words. Yeah.
Goodness. but we are talking about Poltergeist, which was released in 1982. It was directed by the late great Toby Hooper, although there is some controversy surrounding that. What? Oh, not his name, just whether he directed it or not.
No,
some people say Spielberg did. Sure, like he was heavily involved.
And this stuff all works as long as the audience can find some logic for it. You know, that's why I wanted to do that. Just a little transition from the ghost at the top of the stairs to just for a moment the beast. Ghost stories usually avoid seeing ghosts. And when they do see ghosts, they're three-dimensional and they're real people. So this is it.
Spielberg made a comment about how Toby wasn't a real like get up and go kind of guy, so he would step in and do things, and then later recanted it when he realized how fucking rude that was to Toby. Right. But yeah, so it is definitely a collaborative effort, I believe.
Right.
So we talked about this in the Gremlins episode too. Like when Spielberg's the executive producer, he gets his hands all up in there. Like,
yeah.
Gremlins is a who the fuck directed Gremlins again?
Not Chris Columbus.
Joe Dante. Yeah, like, see, Joe Dante, Gremlins, Toby Hooper, Poltergeist, these feel very similar. That's because Steven Spielberg gets his hands all up in there. Because
he got the little touchy fingers. Yeah, and, you know, he does great work, so I'm not mad at it at all.
Nicole, this is your favorite movie, right? Is it your favorite movie?
Yes.
Did you see this in the theater?
Yes.
Okay, all right.
Multiple times.
Multiple times. When it first came out?
When it first came out, I saw it 4 times.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
I can't remember if I saw it in the theater. I know we had gotten not allowed to say it now because the FBI is going to come for me, but we had a VHS copy of like E.T. and this movie it was still in the theaters. So
there's no statute of limitations for that. They will come for you.
I wanted to ask you guys, because we open up with the Star Spangled Banner, and before the TV signs off, and I know Nicole remembers this. Adam, are you old enough to remember this?
I am. Like
you are.
What your little intro here is mirroring what I have written down. It's a little crazy. No, it's great. It's totally how I wanted to open. Yeah, like when the national anthem, and then it just like turns to static. I do remember that. And I kind of miss it, to be honest with you. Like,
it's 24/7. Ryan, you're too young for that, right? You don't remember that?
No, they didn't stop doing that in Canada until like 2002.
Really? Wow. Okay.
Yeah. No, I can still remember like being 13, 14, and still getting it. Canadian National Anthem, TV. Obviously.
It was a great honor to outwork the TV.
Yeah. No, and then you'd wake up at 2 a.m. and the TVO logo would be going and just be that loud, piercing,
blaring. Yeah. And then some little child in front of a TV. No, wait, that's something else. Okay.
I actually remember it being quite startling too when it would happen.
If you were not prepared for it, if you were awake and the Star Spangled Banner was happening, then you knew when that ended that was going to happen. But if you were dozing and not paying attention and you were awoken by said noise, that was extremely unsettling.
Yeah. Nowadays, it would just transition into like an infomercial.
Hi, it's Fitz with Slap Chop. You're gonna be in a great mood all day because you're gonna be slapping your troubles away with the Slap Chop. This tuna looks boring. Stop having a boring tuna. Stop having a boring life. Here's a hard-boiled egg. One chop, you add the pickle.
The little angelic Carol Ann. That kid was cute as hell.
Yeah,
she was a little padding down the stairs while dad's passed out in front of the TV.
Yeah, she was a little angel baby. And she starts talking to the television like almost immediately.
Yeah, like, I don't know. What do you mean? What do you look like?
What do you look like? Five. Yes. Yes. I don't
If I woke up and I saw my kid doing that, I would punt them out the door. I swear to you. Creepy kids in the middle of the night.
I kind of sensed from the family, though, that like they knew that she was kind of
special.
Touched.
Yeah, because.
For lack of a better word, like she Diane had shown says it. Abilities. The TV people actually show up. They come out of the TV as little Roger Rabbit cartoons almost into the wall. Parents are getting stoned in the bedroom, and that was the first time I had ever seen like drugs being used in a movie by like regular people.
Yeah,
you know I love what I mean? Their like just like recreationally, like it wasn't like a criminal or whatever.
Right,
you know?
Nobody's like shooting up in a back bathroom. But one thing I did realize that again I never picked up on before, or if I did, I forgot. You know when she goes to put. The only death in this movie is Tweety. I mean, he's the only one that actually dies that we know of. So Tweety, she goes to put him in the box. And Carol Ann says, he doesn't like the smell. And then I realized later it's the same box she's using for her drugs.
For the weed.
So that's where she puts her weed. So Tweety's
she doesn't like
oh.
The weed.
That's why she gave him a little, you know, in case he gets hungry.
Mm. Yeah. I was just thought that was interesting because, you know, it was like the 80s and they had the whole like war on drugs thing.
Okay, last time. This is drugs. This is your brain on drugs.
Well, he's like, reading a book on Reaganomics, like
right, and like back then, like they did not differentiate. like weed was based, you know, if you did weed, you might as well be doing black tar heroin. You know, like drugs were.
I
drugs.
Like that they were just so nonchalant about it, even when the kid walks in. Like she takes another puff before she puts it out. Something I learned while reading today. About this that I never also picked up on before. Did anybody else know that, I guess, supposedly Diane is not Steve's first wife and that Dana is his child and not necessarily hers? When the people come in and they say, you know, what are the ages of everyone in the house? And he says, my daughter, Dana, is 16. My wife is 32.
Right. Which and means she was 15 when she got pregnant.
Right. And so I guess whether it's like in the original draft or something, I read this article where they said it was actually pointed out somewhere that Diane was his second wife. And I don't know how I feel about that, but I'd rather her just get knocked up at 15. It's just where the fairy tale. What's up?
I guess.
I don't know. It just, I never did the math before till I read that. And I went back and I was like, yeah, son of a bitch. Like, think so.
They could have just been high school sweethearts and she got pregnant.
He was not. She was 32. He was not.
No, we talked about this in another movie. Okay. It was in Critters. For all we know, Craig T. Nelson was like 29 in this. Okay. The 80s. People just looked different. They just looked older. Men were bald by 22.
What are your thoughts about this whole setup here, Nicole? Like the family and, you know, how the movie opens.
It's one of the reasons I fell in love with the movie.
Yeah.
They were the perfect family. They were fantastic. They loved each other unconditionally, but they also fought and, you know, arguments at the breakfast table and, you know, things like that. The parents were still playful with each other, which was nice, you know, and it was just the all-American family. Loved it.
And they're just they were just hashtag relationship goals as far as
100%. Yeah.
I don't like the tree outside that kid's room.
So I learned
you're not supposed to like the tree. The tree is useful.
So I read up, they said both of the terrors that plagued Robbie came from Steven Spielberg's own fears as a child, the fear of clowns and the tree outside his window growing up.
Yeah. Well, he goes, you know, he's like, I don't like that tree. And I'm like, yeah, I don't blame you, kid. Like,
I don't blame you.
Nothing is growing on it. It's like tree in name only.
Well, he climbed the hell out of that tree at the beginning, though. He got right up there.
It almost looks like one of the sculptures from that mom in Beetlejuice.
Yeah.
Now she always makes those like weird insectoid looking sculptures.
Yo.
They also have like, there's those people that are putting in the pole.
That are just like taking her coffee and
they're just like taking her coffee and like their daughter is like going to school and they're like catcalling her.
Yeah, that was a little gross now.
She is like 14, sir.
I love you. I love you. And I'm just like, and the mom is like listening to the whole thing.
And then she watches her flip him off and she's like, yeah, that's my kid.
Yeah, she was like,
ha. Yeah, no, it was the 80s. Those construction workers were probably like 16 or 17.
Although she was in real life older.
Or just got released.
Because she died like the next month. Everybody knows that the swimming pool, that they use real skeletons, right? Like that's a pretty known fact. That the part that I didn't know is that Joe Beth did not know that they were real till after they finished shooting it. He didn't tell her. And I thought that was kind of wild.
That would be shocking. Nicole, walk us through the scene where they, the chair scene, where they the chair scene.
I thought this was one of the funniest scenes, the way she ran out to get Steven as he came home from work and he still had the trash can in his hand and he couldn't get through the door and it was very comical. So he just comes home from work one day and she's got masking tape all over the floor and she puts a chair in the center and it shakes and it flies across the room. It just slides right across the floor and he's in shock. And then she puts her daughter there. Puts a little Rams helmet on her head, giant Rams helmet on her head, and slides her into the circle and she just slides down to her father and mommy, that burns. Floor needs more wax. And she just starts to describe what's happening and there's this tickling and it starts to pull you and there's no air but you can breathe and they have no idea what's going on. And she's loving it. She thinks that this is just a fantastic, other side, of the universe type thing happening. And
like
it does not turn out to be fantastic.
Like there's such a thing as being optimistic about a situation like this. And then there's like throwing caution to the fucking wind. Let's put my daughter in this mystical circle and then I'm going to do it. And it's like, wow.
I always thought I'm sorry. Go ahead, Nicole.
The way she describes it, she had to have done it too.
Yes.
So she knew there was no real danger, And I have to admit that if I were in her position, I would do the same thing. I would be reacting the same way.
That night, Carol Ann is taken. And
we have the storm coming in. And I noticed when Robbie climbs the tree at the beginning, he looks up and you just see these like ominous clouds rolling in. And it's just such a cool scene. And then that's where we learn the trick to tell whether the storm is moving closer or farther away.
I don't know if it's true, but I still do it to this day.
It is true, and I learned it watching that movie, and I have done it ever since I was a kid.
What is it? What is the trick?
The trick is when you see the lightning, then you count till you hear the thunder.
When you see the lightning, you count till you hear the thunder. If you can count higher each time, that means the storm's moving away from us. Want to try it? One, two, three. Okay, but I bet you next time you're going to be able to count to at least four or five.
Well, the ghosts have a great plan that they completely what's the term I'm looking for?
By have a tree eat a kid.
By
create a distraction.
Distraction. Thank you.
You're welcome.
That shouldn't have been that hard. Yeah, but anyway, they have the evil dead rape tree that takes their kid.
Jesus.
Well, thankfully, it doesn't go that far.
No. Goodness. That scene when they come back and all the shit's in the closet and they start throwing stuff out of the closet and they find this figure underneath and they both just, like, their face is just crushed, like their child is dead, and then it's the clown under there instead. Yeah. Fucking clown.
And they're just ignoring their son, who's just...
Who's sitting there just bleeding and crying.
Standing there like he just got back from the Great War. Just looks like the thousand-yard stare. And no one's even, like... No one's even, like, checking on him. He's just like...
I'm gonna say it right now. That family is amazingly well-adjusted in the sequel for all the shit that happens all to the Bridget movie. Mm-hmm.
They went through them. It's true. Diane gets the idea that she fell in the pool. Steven dives. I mean, it's just so... Their fierceness of finding their child is so moving to me.
Yeah.
Just, you know, and then Robbie hears Carol Ann in the TV. And... God, I love him to death, but I wanted to slap.
Yeah. His acting in this is a little questionable.
Carol Ann's in the TV, I guess.
The alternate universe or whatever it is. It's like she's like in limbo, right?
She's in another dimension somehow. So
she's in the process of crossing over. She's stuck
in the
somewhere between here and the other side.
Yeah.
Sorry, I should have said that like a tiny little woman with a bit of a New Orleans drawl.
There is no death. It is only a transition to a different sphere of consciousness. Caroline is not like those. She's with.
And Dr. Lesh, Marty, and so what's his name?
Ryan. Is it like
Ryan?
Craig T. Nelson. Like he has to go to the university to find these people.
I missed that when I was a kid.
I like how he just slowly deteriorates throughout the movie. Like he looks like shit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Hasn't slept in days.
He looks like he hasn't slept. He's just a nervous wreck. I mean, he almost. More so than any other of the characters in this, really shows signs of like PTSD.
So they bring these people in. Let me ask you all a question. If you were working in someone's house, would you just go and like chow down on their food in their fridge?
No, yes. I've written down too.
Yes.
Yes.
I know you would.
110%.
Okay.
And if they came into the kitchen while I was doing it, be like, you want me to warm some of this up for you too?
Well, I definitely wouldn't take a steak.
Well, that was just the. I think was like, the steak that's a meal. Out or did he bring it out? Like I can't. The chicken.
He
I
took
know.
It out of the fridge.
Okay. Yeah. But
then it started turning into like maggots or whatever.
I'm going to interject here and get Nicole's because we talked about this on the fucking Amityville 2 episode we just did.
Mm-hmm.
Did you get a chance to rewatch this face ripping scene
from Poltergeist? That's
yeah.
Oh, I don't need to rewatch it. It replays in my head every day. Obviously, Poltergeist had a bigger budget, and it just looked more realistic. I understand it was 1982. It's not going to look real, but it was a lot better than Amityville 2. Amityville 2 was awful. It was like rubber this thick cracking instead of skin. You know, at least in Poltergeist with the skin, it looked like it was ripping. You know,
yeah, it still freaks me.
And it looked like flesh and muscle hitting the sink.
Yeah,
poor Marty. Did not look like that.
Like he
at
went
all.
Through each layer.
Face off, but
I feel like that was like the one day. I feel like Toby Hooper was waiting around the set, waiting for Spielberg to go home or go to sleep or something. And then he was like, "All right, hurry up, guys! I'm gonna
shoot rip my face off.
I'm gonna shoot this scene." And it's like, okay, there's the one scene where you're like, "Oh, this is a Toby Hooper movie."
That's a Toby Hooper movie.
And it was Steven Spielberg's hands.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, ripping the skin off. You're right.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it was Spielberg's hands in front of the dummy head. Yeah.
I mean, to be fair, he's the same man that gave us Kali Ma. So, I mean, I feel
or the Nazis getting their faces melted off.
Yeah, he's not above.
That's a good point.
He's not above ripping a face.
Right.
I do love the idea, though. You've put the idea in my head now that Toby Hooper would like. It's like teenagers waiting to have like a fucking party, wait for the parents to get out of the house.
Yeah.
I love that idea, and that is canon in my head.
Or like the kid in Deadly Friend, he like roofies his mom. Like maybe he just slipped Spielberg something in his. He's like, Come on, let's shoot this scene real quick. I just want to know who are your favorite? Who is your favorite character in this movie? I'll go last. Abby, you can go.
Honestly, Diane. She has been my hero my whole life. She is who I wanted to be if I was going to be a mother. You know, kids are kids, but I just thought she was fantastic.
Tangina.
Yeah.
Magic. I like Tangina. Like I said, that friggin' Southern or New Orleans drawl she's got, and she's just so fucking sure of herself. The confidence that woman just brings into the room. Like, she knows she's right until she's not.
Until she's not right. But,
but I mean, she wasn't around to find out she was wrong. So in her head, she's still right.
Still I feel like there's some fake it until you make it with her too, because a lot of this supernatural stuff she's never encountered before.
I'm a huge fan of fake it till you make it.
Yeah.
Live my life that way.
Diane. I wanted her to be my mom.
Yeah.
She was. Oh. That's why I love this movie so much. Like, I wanted to be a part of that family. You know, she was fantastic. Literally go to the ends of the earth and beyond for her kids. Mm-hmm. You know,
Mama, she was awesome.
Yeah.
My that favorite character is Dr. Lesh.
Mm-hmm. Really? Okay.
Wait, which one's that? Is that the curly the lady. Girl?
Beatrice Straight. The redheaded. Dr. Lesh. That's her name.
But yeah. Yeah. Beatrice Straight.
Just before you jump into your answer, can I point out that what Nicole just said there was probably the most wholesome and beautiful thing that will ever be said on this fucking show?
What, that I wanted her to be my mom?
That just everything you said was just like everybody else is giving. Like, I'm giving the fact that Tangina is just a fucking narcissist, and that's why I like her. And then you give this just poignant and beautiful response.
But anyway, Dr. Lesh is my favorite character. Like, she doesn't even have a lot of lines. The acting that she does with just her eyes, she has giant, enormous, empathetic
emoting eyes. Yes.
Yeah. And it's just like, and she, you can just tell that she sympathizes with this family so much. She bonds with Diane like almost immediately. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she's basically just there. Her character is basically just there to bear witness.
Yeah.
To this, the struggles and sacrifices of this family. And you know, I think she's, in a lot of ways, I think she's the heart of the movie. Because, like, she's almost us. She's almost the audience watching these events unfold, and she reacts in very similar ways that maybe we will. Yeah.
She comforts Robbie greatly in the scene at night when they're all sleeping in the living room, and they have that whole talk. Yeah.
And this is good night, lady.
Yeah.
Talking about the man coming out of the cave and seeing the moon for the first time and throwing rocks at it. And she gives him that whole story, and it was very soothing for him.
Going through my, you know, my studying and trying to find out stuff that I never knew before. And I was reading this thing that said, when the clown attacks Robbie and, you know, wraps him around his neck, that the machinery was pulling too tight. And he was like screaming, he can't breathe. And they thought he was just ad-libbing.
Oh God!
And then Spielberg saw his face in the, like, going purple.
This is why 80s movies hit better, because child endangerment wasn't a thing yet.
No, you just not at all.
Fucking murdered
the Twilight Zone movie
for a PG movie,
right? Yeah. Case in point, when the epic scene happens, and like, I don't know, they're like filming the stairs and all those orbs are floating down.
Love
and,
that part.
Yeah, it's a great scene. But the very next day, like, they're getting their kids the hell out of Kansas. And like, Robbie just takes a cab by himself.
Yeah.
And the dog.
It's almost like he called the cab. It was like, I'm getting the fuck out of here.
Not with this shit.
The two scenes were, if I've had any amount of alcohol in me, I'll start crying like a toddler. There's a scene where Carol Ann actually passes through her mom when she's in
and she can smell
the
ghost her
version. Feet. Yeah, and she's like having everybody smell her on her clothes, and I'm just like, oh my God. It's so tender. You don't feel that way? Right?
Oh,
yeah. You gave me the rock eyebrow, so I'm assuming that you don't feel similarly.
The emotional impact that all y'all seem to feel with this movie is lost on me, and I think that's probably where this gap is in our appreciation of the film.
Yeah, or that nostalgia drug.
There must be a different version they shipped to Canada. I don't understand. Like, did they take these scenes out? There was big confusion on my part as a viewer about whether sometimes Carol Ann was told to go to the light. Sometimes she was told to stay the hell away from the light. Then she'd be told to go to the light again.
Sorry, just to, Nicole, you're the expert here. What Tangina? What's going on there? Because Tangina does give them the almost exact opposite. Like, is there something we're missing here?
No, I don't think there's anything you're missing. I think if you remember when we first, when Diane first calls Carol Ann, when Dr. Lesh is there, and Dr. Lesh says, tell her to stay away from the light. Because you don't want her crossing over, you know.
Yeah.
And then during that whole speech, she's trying to get her to go to the light because Diane's going in there to meet her where the light is. Because the light's right there, you know, like in the closet. So Diane's going in and she needs her to connect with her, to meet up with her.
So the
right
light,
where the light is.
So the light on their side is like literally just two sides of a door.
It's like a port.
Yeah, the light
but
is
they can't
like...
come. Yeah, but they can't come back through the closet because that would then be going to the other side, which is why they come out through the bathtub. Or no,
right,
they, come through the living room.
Living
yes.
room ceiling is the portal.
Yes.
Is the other end. Yeah.
Like I got this. Good. I'm following.
All right.
I'm smart.
speaking of the light, though, when she's about to enter the closet, which is like the portal or whatever. What an effective scene. First of all, if you just walked in, you hadn't seen the movie, you just walked in on that scene. Like, what a romantic scene. Like, it's just them, like, yeah. they're, like actual Dr. Lesh, like, backs everybody out of the room so that they can have their moment. Mm-hmm. And that whole scene is just done with a couple of box fans and a strobe light.
Yeah.
And it's, like, it's amazingly intense for, like, how practical and minimal it is, you know?
You know when Diane meets the big creature outside the bedroom that's trying to keep them out of the bedroom? I just learned that that was actually like a puppet controlled by a puppeteer in a thing of water, like submerged in water, and that's what gave it its like ghostly...
Oh, give the hair the little...
Yeah.
Floaty...
Herbal Essence commercial kind of.
I thought that was, and then they like just put a light behind it to make it look all shimmery. I just thought they like the cool things that they did to make such stellar effects. It works so well.
I felt a little cheated that like when she goes through the portal, and I get it, it's 1980, what is it, 82?
82.
Like we don't see what happens. Like the next moment, she's just coming out of the portal, like they're being reborn into the world, and, because she couldn't find her way around in there, and people were chasing her, and this, that, and the other thing. And her mom found her pretty quick.
Well, I think when Steven dropped the rope, she ran and grabbed her kid. Man, she was on a mission. Her kid was the most important thing. She was going to protect her.
Now, the remake is a piece of shit, but...
She acclimated to her surroundings, which was the other side, and found her daughter. Within
have
like
you seen
five those? Minutes, mate? That's not the answer.
But that's what I liked about it. We don't see it. We have to imagine it. Mm-hmm. We have to picture it ourselves.
Yeah,
what is it like in
and we just know when you come out, you're goopy.
Yeah,
again, like birth.
They had the grape jelly all over them.
Ugh, makes me gag. It really does.
All right. So here's another question. So now they're safe, supposedly, right?
This house is clean.
Wake up in the tub, and Tangina is like, "This house is clean." The famous scene. But as
clean or clear? Out,
clear clean. Or clean? No, it is clean.
Clean.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'll be damned. Okay.
I think. But as it turns out, that's not true.
Nope.
So, what happened there?
Tangina fucked up.
Is that basically it? She fucked up?
She had never, you said it yourself. She had never seen something like this before. This is the beast. This is obviously a lot more powerful than she thought. I mean, I'm sure some of it was cleared out, but not the beast.
She didn't sense anything.
But at the same time, we've got several movies in this franchise, and I know it's cheating to bring up the other movies, but maybe it was clean. Who's to say they can't fucking come back? The bodies are still buried under the house.
My interpretation is that she fucked up. It wasn't... I mean, she got the kid back, which was, of course, you know, the whole point. But no, I think her getting the kid back does not mean that the spirits are gone. And I wanted to smack both the parents for trying to spend another fucking night in there.
That is true. That is true.
Like, yeah. Really? I would have been out that night. I would have had my kid in that car.
It was like 1984? When did this movie come out?
82.
It's 1982. A hotel would have been like $8.
Yeah. Holiday Inn on I-74.
Right. Yeah. You could add each of your kids take a cab separately to go to the hotel.
Yep, exactly. Alone.
But no, I'm definitely team
and different hotel.
Yeah, one for the dog. I'm definitely team Tangina. I think that for all purposes, the house was clean. It's just the evil was so strong that it just was like, fuck it,
round two,
bitches.
And they're going to pack up and go. And she says, are we staying here tonight? And he's like, fuck, no, we're not. I'm getting out. So
I learned his lesson.
She's going to take care of her little punk rock gray hair.
Yeah, it was hot, by the way. The little...
It was kind of roguish. But
Rogue from X-Men Street.
Yeah.
This is when we get the Robbie getting strangled by the clown. Of all the things not to pack, they didn't pack the clown. Yeah, which is one of the creepiest scenes because it's one of those he's looking under the bed and everything's just quiet. There's no scary music. There's nothing. It's just quiet. And then bam. And Jo Beth is blow drying her hair. She can't hear anything. And she turns it off and she lays down in the bed. And that's when it starts. It's like the jersey flies up. She starts spinning around the room. You know, it's.
She certainly does.
It's terrifying. It is. now, Greg, you can see with the effects that it's
titillating. Terrifying.
Yes,
I think it still holds up though. It looks really good. You know,
Jo Beth definitely holds up. Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, she does. She does.
She holds something up.
Jumping around the room. I was saying her hair holds up remarkably well because she's on the ceiling and it's not hanging down at all. So you can tell that it's like a revolving room.
You know what? But just dropped another star.
What? Oh, because of the hair?
Yeah. Oh.
She falls into the pool. We have the scene where all the bodies are jumping out of the pool and her neighbors, pieces of trash neighbors, like, don't help her at all. Like, nope. You hear her children screaming, and these sons of bitches are like, yeah, no, we're good. Thanks, pal. So, the fact that you've got this woman screaming, her children screaming, and you're just like, I'm going to go bed. I'll see you later. Like, I'll never forgive him.
They did not.
So, isn't it the neighbors that pull her out of the pool?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the asshole that had the same frequency on the.
Yeah, so he does help her.
Helps pull her out of the pool, but then won't help her save her kids.
There are levels of heroism.
Yeah, I guess, you know.
I'm just saying, like, he did something. He's like mid-tier yeah. here.
He's like, I'll save
he
you.
He needs to be up here. He needs to be up here, but he's kind of down here.
Mm-hmm.
Just have to mention that the house gets sucked into a black hole.
Oh, big old hole.
While James Karen Mr. Pathmark.
You move the headstones, but you never move the bodies.
No, son of a bitch. Yes, okay. That scene is so powerful. So, yes.
When you insert the clip of the house collapsing on itself, insert the clip from The Simpsons, not from the movie.
Okay.
Before we get to the ratings, Nicole, is there anything else you wanted to say about Poltergeist?
Greatest movie of all time.
All time, wow. It's not a Spielberg movie, but it is, you know. Mm-hmm. But there's definitely, this movie has, I mean, it's movie magic. It's up there with some of the greatest movies ever made, and it deserves to be in that category. I'm going to give it 5 out of 5. 5 out of 5 bird and bees talks that should have been given to Jo Beth Williams way sooner than when she was 15.
What are their ages?
This Diane, my wife, she's 31. That's 32. I'm sorry. And my oldest daughter, Dana, she's 16.
This, again, is in my top 5 favorite movies of all times. It is... I think it still holds up really well every time I watch it. And like I said, I've seen this movie. I can't even count the number of times, and I'm still picking up things I never noticed before. And I love that. Now, it could just be that I have brain damage and I don't remember stuff anymore, but I think I'm learning new things. So I am going to give this a 5 out of 5 creepy goddamn trees that try to eat your children.
Good one.
Okay, so you guys
are old.
All seem to really love this movie, and that's great. I love that for you guys. I love Thank that you. There's this emotional connection for you. I never got that. I fucking love Tangina. I think she's a fucking hoot and a half. The effects, we did touch on the effects a few times. They're fun. They're, you know, it feels like Ghostbusters. Like, we get those broad puppets, the purple, and the... I'm a sucker for magenta. That's about it for me. I don't find this movie scary. I don't find it overly engaging. I have more fun with the sequels than I do with Adam's getting really upset. Nicole's got like a half smirk going on. I'm sorry.
Don't get it.
The movie doesn't hit me the same way it clearly hits you guys. I'm going to give it 3 out of 5 headstones that got moved, but they never moved the bodies.
You son of a bitch, you moved the cemetery, but you left the bodies, didn't you? You son of a bitch, you left the bodies and you only moved the headstones! You only moved the headstones!
Not even a 3.5, a 3.
Well, actually,
this movie is just a huge part of my childhood. It's the family I always wanted, you know. And nobody dies, surprisingly.
For Tweety,
except for Tweety, yeah. but for me, this is the greatest movie of all time. It's the only movie on Earth that I know backwards and forwards. I know every line. And I can watch it. I do watch it. Usually around once a month, I still watch it. So I'm giving this 5 out of 5 rattling teacups in Dr. Lesh's hand.
Good one.
Good one. I like that. One.
Nice.
Nicole, thank you so much for joining us this time around. We really appreciate it. Abby, do you want to read out our socials real quick? Or?
Yeah. So you guys, if you want to email us, it is hormonalwerewolves@gmail.com. Look us up on YouTube, Hormonal Werewolves, the number 3 on YouTube. And also on Facebook, we have a page and a group. We'd love for you to join. So check us out. We're on Instagram, X, Blue Sky, you name it. You'll find us. Just look for the Hormonal Werewolves, the number 3. And you'll find us.
Nicole, before we head out, do you have anything you want to put out there in the world for people to know about?
Absolutely. Scream Until You Like It. Facebook page, Instagram, Twitter, everything.
OnlyFans.
YouTube. I'm sorry?
OnlyFans. You guys have one.
OnlyFans.
No, we do not have OnlyFans.
That's where Mike does the rest of his cologne.
Yes. YouTube as well. It's convention news, movie news, trailers, all kinds of fun stuff, interviews.
All right, everybody. Well, thank you very much. And we will, from the werewolves and Nicole and Scream Until You Like It, I guess, we'll see you next week.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, bye, bye.
Right?
Yeah.
Where do you think he's gonna come back to? Back to his lair.
We'll be ready for him.